So I want to thank everyone for coming and joining us today. Since the pandemic started in March, Bruce and myself and Lainey have been holding weekly pipe ceremonies via Zoom. And this is an attempt to keep our communities connected. And it started out as kind of like this local effort and has become a global response. So every Sunday at this time, we usually do a pipe ceremony. And then about once a month, we've tried to invite different elders, teachers, shamans, pacos, curanderos, people that we have relationships with, either as the Naraya community or in our own personal life. And we've kind of turned the time over to them to offer teachings. And this month we invited Benson to join us. And in talking to Benson, I thought he came up with a wonderful topic to discuss with us. I know he's very excited about it. We've talked several times about this topic, and I will turn the time over to him in a moment. When Benson is at a place in his presentation for questions, or if throughout the presentation you have questions, if you would just type it up in the chat box, and when Benson's at a point where he's open to questions, I will share his questions with, I will share your questions with him so that he can respond to them. And so with that, I'm gonna turn the time over to Benson Lanford. Round of applause, yay.
I'm very honored. Am I to start speaking now?
You are on.
Well, I'm absolutely honored, and I appreciate the chance to pass on some things that I've heard about or learned or observed through my 79 years. I just turned 79 in October, and I'm wearing a wonderful bandolier bag that I'm going to stand up and point to the owls that wonderful sister like friend Sarah Holmes made for me. And the other side, I'm wearing a bandolier that my another sister friend, Janet Lambert, made. So I'm well dressed and ready to go. I'm very honored and pleased. Thank you. Names, my goodness, where to go? I wish we had a whole week at a camp out. I think we'll start with, most of us probably don't realize how many Native American / American Indian names hover around us. And there are actually 8 states that are based on Native American tribal names. And I'm going to mention the tribes by name and see if you can guess the state. I bet you can. Alabama, Illini, Iowa, Kansas, Missouri, North Dakota, South Dakota, and Utah. Did you get those?
I
bet you did. And I'm going to mention that I'll issue some homework for you folks to continue studying about this topic. There are some cities, for example, that come from Indian names. Chicago, for example, is one. And do you have any idea what Chicago means? It's in the Chippewa and Potawatomi languages that are very closely related. It means place that stinks. Oh, yes, and it's because along Lakeshore Drive in earlier days, before it was all nice beach, it was pretty swampy. And there were lots and lots, miles and miles of wild, not onions, but garlic that would spoil in late spring and stink for the rest of the summer. So you didn't want to go skinny dipping in the so-called beach along Chicago back then. Seattle is another one. Malibu, Poughkeepsie. That means a reed-covered pond-like area. Some others that we ought to know about, Muncie, Indiana, for example, and Malibu. All of those come from Indian names. I'd like to mention that some tribes use names formally that are not their own names for themselves. And some use both their traditional name and the one that's become, well, formal. For example, Cherokee, that's a Choctaw word, Talagi, Cherokee. And that means people who live in the caves, because in the Smoky Mountains, they had wonderful rock shelters that they could hold feasts in and put up guests who had gathered for gatherings. But the tribal name for themselves is Aniyungwiya. Aniyungwiya, meaning we're the guys, we're the people. And actually, I'm an eighth Cherokee, Aniyungwiya. My dad used to say he was proud to be Scotch-Irish and Cherokee. Another one is the groups known as Sioux, S-I-O-U-X. And that comes from the ending of the Chippewa and Ottawa names for them, Nottoway Sioux. Nottoway Sioux, that's the plural ending. Alone, it doesn't really mean anything. But the first part of that name for the Sioux, or Dakota and Lakota, is Nottoway, and that means a snake or an enemy. So it's literally the enemy people is what Sioux comes from in Chippewa and Ottawa. Well, let me look at my my notes here. There are some other names that are words that are very, very common that come from various languages. For example, chipmunk, moose, hominy. Well, both the town and the food, hominy. Moccasin, the word moccasin, and teepee, and wigwam, and papoose, and even the word pecan, you know, those things we make great pies with. Powhatan, or Powhatan, means powwow hill. And the famous person Pocahontas, literally, that's a nickname for her, and it meant the playful one, Powhatan. Tecumseh means shooting star or a blazing comet. That's Tecumseh. So it's really fun to poke around, look at your state map or even your city map for, street names or whatever. But you might even consider yourself. Some personal names come from Indian languages. Now, numbers of languages traditionally have a special word for firstborn son, firstborn daughter, secondborn son, secondborn daughter, etc. For example, in Lakota, Sioux, Dakota, the Eastern group too, Haka is a firstborn boy, but guess what the firstborn girl is? Winona. And there are some people you might know named Winona, some ladies. I'm gonna peek at my notes here and make sure I'm staying on track. I'd like to mention that Indians love nicknames. And you can have several nicknames like this guy sitting in front of you and rambling on. I have a couple of formal names. So let me say those first, maybe. When I was a young boy, 7 or 8 years old, I took the name, which is a custom you can do, take a name for yourself, Two Owls, because I was always fascinated with a pair of barn owls that lived in our neighborhood in Detroit. I was from the Detroit area originally, then moved to Toledo in the third grade with my family. So Two Owls is a name that I consider to be my first formal name, and I retain that. And I still like owls and wear owl jewelry. Another formal name that I have was given in a sweat lodge ceremony in South Dakota. A friend of mine and I traveled to South Dakota for the Christmas celebrations back in the early 70s. And I wanted to sponsor a Uiki ceremony. Maybe 100 people showed up for that. The day after, I sponsored a sweat lodge, which the leaders of a Uiki ceremony, that's a big gathering ceremony, they have to undergo a sweat lodge ceremony. And because I fed those, you know, arranged for the food, that is, for the sweat lodge, and then all of the food for close to 100 people the next day, they honored me with a name. The sweat lodge leader, Adam Eaglefeather, presented me with a name that I was blown away. I had no idea this was coming. And that is Tonkan Saichia in Lakota. That means gray stone. And it's important to realize in Indian names that often there are two completely different words, maybe even three, for different types of an object type. For example, stone in Lakota can be Iyan, and that's also the name of a great spirit type person or being. Iyan is stone, but Tonka is the name for the stones used in the sweat lodge. And San Ichia means one that has become gray in color. Tonkan San Ichia, gray stone. Well, after I was given that name, and a couple of days later, we went to some ceremonies. I should back up. The young fellow that went with me, Bob Clare, was also given a name to honor him because he had driven us and was participating in these doings. And he was named Iktomi Hunzi. Iktomi is spider, and that can also refer to a joking type spirit. The spider is a joker. He'll fool you if you let him. But Hunzi means yellowish color. Well, a couple of days later, when we went to other doings, people would ask, do you have Indian names or do you have real names? And I'd give mine, and they'd open their eyes and realize that that was a name bearing quite a bit of honor for something I had done. I guess I had fooled them enough to get a name like that. But Bob's name, when we tell them, Yellow Spider, they would grin or laugh and smile and shake their heads. They realized that not only is that a friendly name to give somebody, but it's kind of a teasing name. So that'll bring smiles when he's announced in the Indian public. Name giving. Oh, there are so many ways names can come about. Among some of the tribes, clan names can be a whole list of clan names. By clan, I mean a group within a given tribe that makes people related ceremonially, like Deer Clan or Bear Clan, or they go on and on. So names, maybe a dozen even, from different clans can be held by individuals in addition to a nickname, clan names. And naming ceremonies, oh my, they can be wonderful. I want to tell you about Luella Johnson, who was like a sister to me, full-blood Crow, crossed to the other side camp about a year ago. She lived her whole life on the Crow Reservation in Montana, spoke old-fashioned traditional Crow language, modern Crow, and English. And I taught her a few solid words too, and she always loved using those, like wado means thank you, or wado osda. Whoops, getting off the track here. The last time I was in Luella's presence, my great pleasure and honor, maybe 10 years ago in Montana on the Crow Reservation, I was in the area and had made arrangements to go visit and stay with her and her wonderful husband. But there was a naming ceremony for a young boy who was about 10 years old and had already begun to show great interest in Indian ceremonies and pipe use and all. And they asked Luella's elderly father to name this boy. But he ended up being in the hospital, close to being on his deathbed. And Luella would go visit him, of course. And he had actually dreamed a name for this young boy. Well, at this big gathering in a huge tent, Luella asked me to come up front and sit with her, facing the front like all of the other people who were seated in the giant tent. And she stood right next to me to present this little boy's name. And he stood on the other side of her from where I was. But she turned and faced the same direction that everybody else did, facing the front of the tent, so her back was to everybody. And you might think that that's an unusual thing, but, well, I'm seated right next to her, and out of the side of my eyes and kind of looking up at her, I could see that tears began streaming down her face and would drip on her dress, and she wouldn't even try to wipe them off. And the whole front of her dress was tear-soaked, and she explained that her father indeed did give the boy the name that she was going to pass on to him. And she was so touched that he asked her to present the name, carry the name on to the boy, and she knew that he was going to cross to the other side camp soon. Well, the name, and I can't pronounce it in Crow, if I could even remember it, is he takes them to the pipe. And that's a heavy, heavy name to honor somebody who is interested in and participates and leads ceremonies. And that's to encourage that person to continue those that involvement and that kind of interest for his people. He takes them to the pipe, or he leads them to the pipe. Very impressive name. And of course, after that, there was a big feast. And the little boy walked around after everybody was eating, and he said, "Guess what they called me?" He was very, very pleased and honored and recognized even that at that young age the importance of that name. Let me peek at my notes and see where I'm going. Oh, another person with a similar name is, he prays for them. And that's a member of a Crow person that I know also. He prays for them. I'd like to mention a bit more about nicknames. Let's see, where do I begin here? Well, how about I'll tell you a couple of mine and you can tease me in the future. Well, another formal taken name that I took just recently is Red Spider, because I like spiders and I like snakes and owls, but the spider, remember, is a trickster and can lead to teasing things, Red Spider. And one of the ways you can take a name for yourself is to be aware of your surroundings and things that hover around you, or that things that you see. And I used to like to sit on our front porch in the house we lived in Ashland before we moved to Talent 5 years ago. And there were hanging pots of flowers just overhead. And I'd be working on beadwork or restorations of things on a small table. And I'd look down and there'd be one, two, or three, or sometimes even more tiny red spider mites on my hands or on the thing I was working on or on the tray of beads or wherever. They had fallen off the potted flowers on me. And because I like spiders, and because the color red, remember, among most people is a ceremonial or sacred color, I thought Red Spider would be a good nickname. But there, in the Siouan languages, Dakota, Lakota, there are two colors for red. One of them translates to Red Cloud, a chief that you've, I'm sure, heard his name. And he was given the name Machpia Luta. Machpia is cloud, and Luta is like crimson or a sunset or sunrise color, a lighter red, because on the day he was born, there was a huge, unusually shaped, swirling cloud of that color of crimson in the western sky. So they blessed that child with that name, and he retained that as a formal name his whole life. He probably had some nicknames too of the family and all, the tribe, but Machpia Luta, Red Cloud, was his name for life. Crazy Horse, oh my, The word Witko in Lakota and Dakota, Witko, is often and usually translated as crazy. But sometimes when individuals who spoke their native language and enough English to be a translator, if they were asked to translate something, they might not get it quite right. So Witko doesn't really mean crazy, but to this day, it's translated as crazy. Crazy Horse. Well, Tashunka Witko literally means his horse behaves in a manner that is not really understandable. He's spirited, he's very smart, very wise, and that's what Witko literally means. Very spirited, moves around all the time, gets into things, checks things out, is very friendly, and does things that you don't quite understand. He's not really, you can't quite fathom that person or that animal's behavior. Crazy Horse. Well, I don't know how else you would translate it, so we'll just stay with that name, of course. peeking at my list here. Well, I'm going to mention that I was honored to attend a Sioux naming ceremony in South Dakota. A brother-like friend of mine was actually named Hohoble. That means bone shirt, but that refers to a man-style breastplate that's made out of the long tubular beads made of bones. And one of the things that can be done is if you look like or behave like or talk like, dance like a person with a certain name, that name may be passed on to you. And Dennis Lessard, Bone Shirt, was given that name because he literally did dress quite like and look like a Lakota man, Oglala, or a Mopapa man from Rosebud Reservation, looked like that man, and knew him in former years. So they passed that name on to keep it going and to honor the elder who had crossed over, Hohoogle Bone Shirt. Well, Dennis Lessard's and Rose Lessard's, they had two boys and a girl, and the younger boy, the younger girl, had not received Indian names yet. They had no Indian blood, but were very much involved in the doings of the Rosebud Reservation and other places. And so for months, they started gathering things that they were going to give away to the big crowd that gathered for the naming ceremonies in I think it was in August one year. And they began camping close to a week before the Thursday that they gave the names. There was a feast on Thursday to organize things to make sure everything was going on. All right, and they dug the fire pits to cook the soups and all, but the actual naming was on a Saturday, that following Saturday. And Nancy Whitehorse was asked to name the girl. And after we fed well over 100 people out of two huge vats of soup and fry bread and other things, Nancy stood in front of the sacred fire and the people all gathered looking at her. And she said, "Well, the name I give this young girl is They Look at Her Lodge." And I saw people's heads nodding and people going, "Wow." And she said, "I'll explain for those who don't realize that I'm passing on my own grandmother's name to this young girl. And it's that for months ahead of time, they knew they were going to be the people there at the ceremony were going to be the recipients of a big giveaway. In fact, they gave away a horse to each one of the people who gave the names to the boy and the girl. And they look at her lodge because the grandmother's mother, her great-grandmother, Nancy's great-grandmother, set up a separate teepee just to contain the tremendous amount of goods piled up inside that became the giveaway for the naming ceremony. They look at her lodge. Wow, what an honor, because for the rest of her life, that young girl, people would know about her that the family, mom and dad, had put on a really big ceremony for her to receive that name that honored her. Well, it's going to happen. I've forgotten the little boy's name. It'll come to me. Bear with me, please. I don't know that I wrote these down, so. Oh, I just spotted another couple of tribal names that are not the tribe's own names. One of them is Cheyenne, and that comes from the Sioux people, Shayela or Cheyenne. That refers to them, people who speak a totally different language, that means. But the Cheyenne do use that term as a formal term, both the northern group and the southern group in Oklahoma. But their own name for themselves is Sistas. Well, that's a hard one to say, but you can understand perhaps why they went to an easier name. The Winnebago have done something similar. Winnebago, you've all heard about the car and maybe even the tribe. I live in Wisconsin. And that's a name that the Chippewa gave them in the related language, Potawatomi and Menominee. Say Winnebago or Winnebago. And that literally means people who live by the stinking water. That's because in northern Wisconsin, where there are lots and lots of lakes and marshes, in the hot summer, the water can get kind of a little bit rancid in some areas. So that's a teasing name for the Winnebago. They call themselves Ho-Changara. Ho means the voice or the language, the speaking. And Changara in their Siouan language literally means the first speakers of our kind of language in this area. So Ho-Changara is what the Winnebagoes call themselves. And historians expect that that means they were the first people. Hello, Benji. They were the first people to move to the Western Great Lakes from the Ohio River Valley. And oh, Ohio, that's a Delaware word that means beautiful place. How about that? Wouldn't you like to live there, Ohio? Well, back to Ho-Changara. They shortened the form and used this form more now, Ho-Chunk. Ho-Chunk from Ho-Changara. And it's more likely that, or very likely that, because they opened a casino, it's called Ho-Chunk Casino, because most likely non-Winnebagoes aren't going to really remember Ho-Changara or know how to spell it. So Ho-Chunk Casino. I think that's the points that I wanted to make right there. Well, I see some people smiling, and I hope that means that you're enjoying my babbling here. Oh, Kathy, you're about to laugh. I'll give another nickname for myself. Two, in fact. I belonged to an Indian dance group starting when I was about in the third grade, called the Shupeda Indian Dancers. And that literally means buffalo spirit dancers in Omaha. It was a group of younger guys and into their teens and a few adults who were non-Indian, mixed bloods and full bloods, the Shupedas. And there were two of us who began to do the hoop dance. And perhaps a lot of you have seen hoop dancing at powwows. Well, for quite a while, both of these used just one hoop. And I saw at a powwow a young fellow using three hoops. So I took on another one, thinking, well, I'll lead up to more hoops. So for a while, I was dancing with two hoops. And a couple of the full-blood Indians started calling me Hoops. Hoops instead of Benny or Benson. Well, just before I got married, after I moved back from Mexico City, where I did my undergrad degree in the 60s, I went to a really nice powwow, and there was a, in Michigan, and there was a, dance contest, a northern drum, about five guys sitting around the drum, beat the drum and sang a song that was quite a trick song. And that is, they would beat the drum and sing and slowly lighten up on the beating, the heaviness of the beating, but they would continue the song. And I had witnessed that song sung before at powwows and knew that the men continued dancing. In other words, you dance to the song, not the beating of the drum. So they kept singing without beating the drum, and I kept dancing. But the other two or three dancers stopped dancing and looked around and saw that I kept dancing, and they started up again. And then the drum slowly, softly started beating in time, but softly, and then got louder, and then it ended the song. And of course, you always stop dancing on the last beat of the song. Well, as soon as the song stopped, the elderly Lakota judge, dancing, contest dancing judge, there were three of them, he pointed to me and said, "Sha, sha, sha, sha. Sha, sha," he said it three times, pointing at me each time. Well, in Lakota, in Dakota, I've already mentioned that luta means crimson or light red, but sha, S-H-A, usually written sha, S-H-A, means a darker, richer red, more like Oshie's shirt right there, yeah, I can see. So if you say sha, that means good, solid red. But in the Siouan languages, if you repeat the word, it intensifies it. Sha, sha means really good, strong red. Or if that's for a singular syllable word, single syllable word. But if it's a double syllable, like luta, crimson, you would say luluta. You don't say luta luta. Luluta means really bright crimson. Let me see, the word z, z-i-z is yellow. So zizi would mean bright yellow. Or ska is white. Ska ska, meaning really, really bright white, almost shining like the curtains behind me. Well, if a young person is to receive a name, it can happen in numbers of ways. And someone can be asked to name that person. Well, I've been honored to ask three different people to name them, or asked by one of the families to name a young man. And how do you go about getting a name for a person? Well, you often, an elder or a person who's really involved with the ceremonies, will take it upon him or herself to dream or, well, let's say come up with, decide upon a name. And one way to do it is the way I did it for one young man. We lived in Ashland, Oregon, just south of here a ways, and a beautiful mountain rises to the west, and it's very wooded and has some wonderful paths. And on a walk one day, I came upon a promontory that I thought, oh my, this is an absolutely beautiful outcropping of rocks, a break in the forest. And you can look out over the valley, across the valley to Grizzly Peak, a huge, huge mountain, pointed mountain. And I thought, this is a place that I'll want to come back to. Well, a few months later, that's where I went, walking on a trail that had actual bear tracks. And on the top of that promontory that was about the size of a common backyard in a suburb, it was kind of grassy. And there were bear tracks and bear scratchings in the mud off to the side. And I thought, bears have actually come here. And for some reason, they have congregated, either one or several through the time. And bears by Indian people are considered to have really great personal strength, of course, but knowledge, and they're very wise and very plugged into the spirit world. And any information from or names with the word bear, Mato and Sioux, they're really important, really powerful names. So I stood there looking across the valley to Grizzly Peak, to the east of Ashland, Oregon, and a name came to me that is based on not just that spot, but the fact that I had followed upon a bear trail. And the name that came was Ambling Bear, or bear that walks along. And I talked with a full-blood Lakota friend, a brother-like friend, about that name before I presented it to, in fact, my Brian's son, my own son, I call him, stepson. I talked with my friend about that name, and he just nodded his head and said, that's a great name. And you realize more of what goes behind that meaning. So you tell me. Well, when the bear slowly ambles along, he's looking at everything, noticing everything. He becomes very perceptive and very knowledgeable, and can, in fact, figure out what's going to be happening, what's going to take place. So he can become a person, prognosticate, is that a word? Somebody shake your head, yes or no. I'll go to the names that I have listed just because I think they're fascinating. On the Rosebud Reservation, in the town of Rosebud, there's a wonderful little tribal building with a small display. And for years, a lady who became quite a friend of mine and many others worked there. She would go there and work on doing bead work, or sometimes restoring something. And one day I was visiting and really got to know her. And I'll lead into the main part of the story by mentioning that that week I was camped at the Rosebud Powwow and had set up a little umbrella tent to camp in. And I noticed that across the way, a non-Indian family set up a teepee. Well, the Indians there normally don't use or have teepees for general camping or powwow use. And I'm standing there talking to my friend, whose name I will give you in a minute, and an Indian lady came in and stood in front of the table where I was standing and behind which my friend was meeting. And I use the term American Indian instead of Native American, and that lady looked at me and she said, "Why did you use that term?" I said, "What?" She said, "That I-N-D-I-A-N word. Why did you use that? We're Native Americans." And I said, "Well, just use it all my life, and I've known Native Americans who use it." And she just shook her head, "No." And my friend, whose name I will give you right now almost, said, "Oop, I've been an Indian all my life and I like it just fine." And I think that was a way of apologizing that I had been insulted by this woman. "Well, my friend's name," she said, "do you," speaking to me, and that lady left pretty quickly. She said, "Do you know my full name or my real name?" And I said, "Well, I know your name is Ida, I-D-A, Ida." She said, "Yeah, well, my last name comes from my grandfather as a family name, and it's White Cow Killer." I said, "Oh, I've known you as Ida White." She says, "Oh, but the full name is White Cow Killer." Well, in early days, among the various bands of Sioux, that's especially the Middle Sioux and the Western Sioux, there was a custom of actually going out on a hunt specifically to look for a white or albinistic buffalo and kill it in for a ceremonial reason. And technically they reduced the, and some of the modern people realize this, that they reduced the amount of gene pool in the buffalo, fewer white buffalo or ones with white markings. And they would take that, the skin of that buffalo right there on the prairie where they had killed it in traditional times, leave the body there, not butchered at all, take the hide back to the camp, and people, women who were really pro tanners, would tan that hide perfectly and then stake it out on the prairie as a blessing to buffalo. And I really don't understand fully the ceremonial meaning, but that was the custom. Well, back to Ida White Cow Killer. And she was beating and set down the beads and said, "Oh, White Cow Killer." And she gave it to me in Lakota and said, "That's a long name, so you can just call me Killer." And I just tell people, "Ida Killer." And then I smile, she said, "Ida Killer." And it's all right among traditional people to tease about people's names, or again, use their nickname. And oh my goodness, there are some. And let me look here. Um, Another name that I was given about 8 years ago, I guess, I had been adopted into the Bear River clan of Cherokee people who live in Utah. And I had traveled across the camp with them for 4 or 5 days, be adopted to be given formal tribal membership, which I did not have. And I was given a name. Subsequently, about a month or so later, because one of the elder men wanted to meet me and check me out and then help get a name for me. And he has a brother who's a fluent Cherokee speaker who lives in the southeast, not on in the Smoky Mountains, but farther southeast, who does speak Cherokee or Tsalagi or Ani Yunwiya. And he described me, sent my pictures, told him about what I did there at the ceremony, including I led a pipe ceremony. And the brother sent a name that was presented to me subsequently, and it's Selu Asgaya. Oh, mercy, my heart's beating. Selu in Cherokee means corn, and Asgaya means man, corn man. And the meaning behind it is one who feeds the people, but not so much giving you a hamburger or inviting you to a ceremonial feast, but that I feed your way of thinking and feed your knowledge by passing on things that I have gathered together, like I'm jabbering at you now, passing on, feeding the people in one way or another. So I'm very honored to have that name, Corn Man. Looking here at my list. Well, let's start looking at some other names that are fascinating. Sometimes a name will be translated, or even the native speakers won't know a story, necessarily know a story behind a name. And one of the Meskwaki names, Sac Fox names that I heard years ago is Bear in the Fork of a Tree. We can certainly picture a bear sitting in the fork of a tree, but surely there must be a story behind that. As in this name, Bear Guts. What could that mean, Bear Guts? Oh, I see some smiles. Yeah. Another one is Four Lodges, four teepees or four dome-shaped lodges, four lodges. Another one is Burros, not the Spanish word for donkey, but B-U-R-R-O-W-S, meaning holes in the ground. Another one, Borrows from Others, is the person's name. Borrows from others. What could that have as a source? Another one, Man Not Afraid. And another one, Fears Nothing. My, those must have some great stories behind them. Oh, and I've got a few more. Turn the page. Small Eyes, another one, Killing Woman, Bear Going Up a Hill, Bad Hair, Yellow Eyes, my, another one, Throwing Water, another one, Greasy Woman. Maybe she's been butchering buffalo or tanning hides. Another one, he left his enemy lying in the water. That must have a wonderful warfare story. Another one, he seized a white man and killed him. I'll talk about long names and possible stories. One who mimics. Another one is bead maker. Another one, makes peace. True heart. Steep place. Steep place of a hill or something. What could that mean? Wind feathers on an arrow. Must refer to an arrow maker. Wind feathers on an arrow. Skillful singer. Another one, gladness of heart. Oh, my goodness. Hair cut short. Moccasin tops. Rainbow. Many coyotes. Wounded head. Shot in the leg. My. Small eyes. So I think I told you that one already. So if a person is wanting to get an Indian name, there are several ways, of course, to go about it. Talk to the elders or the people who follow the traditions and lead the ways of doing things traditionally for the tribes. But another way is to excel in doing something so that those who might make a name up for you or derive a name for you can notice what you do well. You're a fine hide tanner, or you break horses, or you what? Okay, you can go on and on with all sorts of possibilities of skills that you could do. But a main way is to petition a person who is known for giving names, or just petition a traditional person. I don't have a traditional name or an Indian name, or I would like another name. Will you get a name for me, come upon a name for me? And they'll either agree to do that or not. And it might take a while, but they might know right away. And usually that name will be presented at a feast of some sort. And among tribes that use the pipe a great deal, pipes will be smoked first, or a pipe smoked first, and then feasting together, feeding each other, taking on life with each other by eating is a part of virtually everything Indian people do. Or you can sally forth in the world and try to figure out what interests you, what color speaks to you, what color you like especially. And oh, a bit about colors. I mentioned Lutha and Sha and Ska having a couple of meanings, either no color like clear or bright white or just white. But the word To, T-O, in the Siouan languages, especially Dakota and Lakota, refers to blue and green, to, unaspirated tea, to. And it literally, they consider green and blue to be shades of each other. It's like the two great colors that you see when you walk out onto the prairie or into a glen in the woods, the green of the grass and the trees and the blue of the sky. And because blue in traditional times for many of the people was an elusive color, tangibly elusive. Well, you saw blue flowers, but you couldn't do much with those. Or blue sky, which covers much of the world. But when they first started getting beads, trade beads coming from the east, I'm not talking about the Southwest and turquoise beads, I'm talking about glass beads coming from Europe, especially Italy and France, but other places. There were four colors most important: black, white, red, and a medium blue or light blue, shades of blue. The light blue is similar to the sky, but there's a medium blue that we call pony trader blue. And they were so taken with the fact that they could get something, beads that they could use, and oh, blue cloth. But the blue beads that they could embroider onto things or string up to wear as necklaces, for example. And they didn't have a name for those glass beads. The Siouan speakers came up with totodang. Dang means a thing. And this is in the Eastern dialect, the Dakota dialect. To, meaning blue or green, but here blue. To, when you repeat it, of course, it means bright or brightly colored or richly colored. Totodang means those blue things. That's what they called beads in general. But if you wanted to see white beads, you'd say todong, tododanska, or todongsha, or todong sapa. Totodang meaning beads, sapa black. Well, let me pause for a second. You can ask, you can think for a second for any questions that you might have that I would either know the answers for or would could make up an answer. Let me look at this.
Benson?
Yes.
There is one question that someone wrote. This might be a good time to ask it.
Sure.
Question for Benson. I noticed a lot of Apodos, nicknames given in Mexico, there are often points of weakness, which then become an affectionate reversal of the vulnerable or vulnerability. Is that common in other indigenous cultural groups?
I think so. In America, like the one name that I gave, Bear Guts, I mean, how would a person get that? My goodness. I'm looking, raises the dust is one, meaning a person never, that was given to an Osage person who never quite behaved, given as a young kid, but became a very active spiritual leader in later life, but raises the dust, meaning it was always getting, going around and getting into things, you know, kicking up the dust. That's one. Another one was small female bear. Well, that means a bear cub that's a female, I guess, but when they translated directly, and that person was as a young person, an Oto, was very much involved in watching the women cook for ceremonies, for example, and would want to help, but here she is like 5 years old. So that's a teasing name, but also serious. A name that I really love in Oklahoma is a family name, Waters, and it means that those people always had lots of sources of water to give people who were passing through, or they would bring flavored water, like with mint or whatever, to ceremonies. And their last name became Waters, and they hold on that today. And even one that's absolutely fascinating is Rough Face. Rough Face. And that is a last name that is still in wide use today in Oklahoma. I think that's Oto. And they refers to a snake shedding its skin in spring. And it becomes very, well, kind of cantankerous and mean, shedding its skin and the scales flipping up on the face, but it's mating time and they become rather obnoxious in their behavior. Another one that I know about is snake in the grass. And that was to tease a younger, older Meskwaki fellow, because he again was always poking around, getting into things, but it also had a warrior meaning. And I think men that had warfare-like meanings, like scalps of them all, that actually gives them encouragement to go on and keep doing what they're doing. But this snake in the grass refers to a garter snake that goes through the grass, but you don't see it and you don't hear it. But that young man became very skilled at sneaking into an enemy village, or sneaking up to it and stealing horses, even into the reservation period. There has to be more. I hope I've made that point.
Yeah, there's another question. Badger's asking, would people wait to name their child till later in their life to be respectful if they were receiving an ancestor's name? And if so, was that due to high infant mortality during those times?
I don't think necessarily. Children have to be named regardless. And they might name a young child with an important name, like from a relative, an ancestor, or a powerful name like Charging Bear or something, to give that young person power and encouragement to do important things, or things with, you know, gusto. There was one person named No Ears, and that referred to a snake. No ears. Well, snakes don't have external ears. And that person was given that name. I think he was a fox Indian of the Sac Fox, Meskwakis. And it was to encourage that person as a young boy to become a warrior, do warrior-like things. You're a snake, you can sneak up to things, and you've got lots of energy and behave in ways that can't be stopped. Blueback, for example, is an important name that refers to the Eastern Siouan tribes of Oklahoma, the Siouan Prairie tribes. They paint a sacred blue paint on the backs of hawks, hawk skins that are used in the bundles as warrior birds in the war bundles. And that name has become a family name and or a personal name, Blueback. Rush is another one from down in that area. That means rushes into battle. And that was given to Joe Rush's grandfather, I understand, a Ponca, who in early years was given the name Rushes into Battle or Rush into Battle to encourage him to become a warrior. Whirlwind in the Lodge. That was given to an Oglala Sioux person, a Lakota, a Whirlwind in the Lodge. And I understand that that meant he was strong enough to stop any family disagreements and fighting. Some of the family members didn't get along very well and fought quite a bit. And he was given that name because he could stop those disagreements in his family.
Benson Dennis is asking.
Oh, another teasing name, if I may, real quickly. The word translates as sleep, S-L-E-E-P, but it refers to the gunk in the eyes in the morning. If the person doesn't wash the eyes first, sleep, go clean your eyes, young guy, young girl.
Harder to ask. Dennis is asking a question. Benson, can you talk about she butchers with her head down?
Talk about some pictures, what?
No, referring to the name she butchers with her head down.
I'm not hearing that word.
Butchers, like a...
cuts up the meat.
Like someone cuts who cuts up the meat. Butchers.
Oh, butchers, she butchers.
Yeah. With her head down.
I would imagine that does refer to either one of two things. Either that she's famous for preparing foods for feasts or is very adept at butchering after a hunt. But in early times, when enemies were killed and run off, the deceased were left on the battlefield and would be cut up through insolence so that they wouldn't go into the other world as a whole body, a wholesome body. Does that make sense? So she butchers the fallen enemies. Is the way that I'm sure that could be used. Excuse me. Oh, am I going to sneeze? No, maybe not. Maybe that could become my name. Going to sneeze.
Amy is asking, is there...
another quick one, I'm sorry. Belcherslaw is another guy's nickname. Okay, it goes on and on. Another question.
Yeah, Amy is asking, is there a different name for rocks used in the Yanipi?
Yes. Well, in the Lakota and Dakota, that's the main Sioux languages, yes, two words. The ones for?
For Yuwipi.
Oh, Yuwipi. I think those would just be Eon. Not a separate word. And used how in the Yuwipi? If they're used in the sweat lodge preparing for the Yuwipi, that would be Tonka. And who was asking that? Wave your hand.
Amy Wolf.
I'm not seeing your picture yet. The yellow's not around you. When I look, look into your eyes. Well, yeah, I don't, you weepy. I have to think about that and ask about that. Do you know Amy? Anything about that?
Well, I don't know the name, and I can't speak on how they're used.
Anywhere. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
I do not know the name, and I can't speak on how they're used.
Uh-huh. I'll have to ask about that. Well, we'll have to have another gathering, y'all.
Benson, I'm wondering, I'm going to shift gears on you a little bit here before we come to a close, but obviously when we started doing these gatherings with our elders, there was a lot of people wanted to get to know their elders a little better. And I'm wondering, when I read your bio, I was very surprised about your story, and I've known you for at least 100 years. And how did this start for you? Like, how did you start getting introduced to Native culture and tradition and language? And, you know, what's a little bit of your story?
Oh, my. You mean me personally, or in general, how do you do it?
No, you. We want to know about you.
Oh, well, let me think. I was born in Melvindale, Michigan, a suburb of Detroit. When I was about 5, we moved to Seabault Street. And there were a couple of boys I began playing with, cowboys and Indians. And they were white guys, like me. But even then, I remember my dad saying he was proud to be, Scots, Irish, and Cherokee, but, you know, 7/8 white guy. And we would play cowboys and Indians, so to speak, and I was never a cowboy. I mean, honey child, I was real. and if somebody had fallen or whatever, I would actually reach down and touch him. And I would say, oh, he has soft skin. He must be an Indian. Where that came from, who knows? But very early on, let's see, I was in the 3rd grade. We moved to Toledo, Ohio. And I remember we went to a street fair, and there were some Polish booths and Italian and Lebanese and a couple of other booths. Oh, there was one Southern booth with cornbread and all that Southern food, but there was an Indian booth, and I was absolutely fascinated, and of course wanted to spend all my time watching that group. But lots of Indian people living in that area in Detroit and in Toledo. And then when I was in the 5th grade, I joined that dance group. So that's how that starts. And my mom and dad were always very encouraging, and we made family friends of full-blood Indian people, and mom would have them over for cornbread and ribs, you know, Southern cooking. And then we'd be invited to some of their homes. And that's the way it started. It start going, yeah. Did I answer?
Yeah, I would encourage people to read the biography that you provided. I posted it on the event. Because like I said, I've known you for all these years, and I just was very enlightened as I read this about you. And I just made me wonder how many people know this about Benson's story. And
I'll add something, if I may. My dad and my sister was 6 years older than me. Both of them showed the genes, you know, wonderful bronze coloring and dark hair. I hated my sister, so to speak, you know, as a young kid, 20, 30 minutes in the sun. And I've said this to others, I'm sure some of you have heard this little story a couple times, but 20-30 minutes in the sun, and my sister showed this beautiful bronzy coloring, and heck, that same amount of in the sun for me, and I was beginning to look like tomato soup, and, you know, don't show it at all.
So is there any other questions?
It's 1:24, and I'm gonna peek over here just to I would add that most traditional Indian people have more than one name, several names, and they can be added during their lives, and they can let a name go, or they can keep all of the names, like I've kept my three main ones. But most of them have numerous names, and they might, oh, another aspect of that, they might in certain situations use one name, and in another situation use a different name. And there's a custom among at least some of the plains and prairie tribes, I think, but plains especially, that if you go someplace and you're alone, and you meet with people from another tribe who don't know you, they'll ask maybe, what is your name or what are you called? You could say, I am the one that they call such and such, and give your own name. Because sometimes, especially with the honorary names, or the ones that show that you're a great warrior, for example, or successful hunter, if you say your own name, that's bragging. And another way to do it, if you're with a group who knows your name, or even one other person who knows your name, and you're telling a story, and it comes to them the instant that you're to give your name, you would stop your speaking, you'd da 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 da, and then the other person would give your name, and then you go on, da 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 da. Anytime your name has to be mentioned, you stop speaking and the other person says your name. And that's to show humility, I guess, yes. I'm sure I'll think of another. Well, there are a few other names that come to mind as I read my notes. Big River, arrow going home, and that might mean hitting its mark. Wavy eyebrows, and I'm sure that's a teasing name. It probably the person does have wavy eyebrows. And of course, it's typical for a lot of the people to completely pull out all facial hair, especially the eyebrows. A lot of tribes did that. Big Hill, Bird Creek, Bad Tempered Buffalo. And those are some other names. Here are a couple Osage names. Red Corn, Hard Rope. What could that mean? Hard Rope. Big Heart, Little Heart. Gives water to the people. Yellow Tree, Yellow Eyes. Well, I may be repeating. Other questions?
Catherine Baca is asking a question about the difference between personal names versus private names.
Personal names and private names. Personal names would be known by everybody, would probably be given to you by somebody or in some situation. But personal names would be ones that you might take on your own and never reveal. But when you would go into, remove yourself from a village, for example, to go on a prayer walk or a private personal ceremony, you might, when you're praying, or singing a prayer song, use a personal song, a personal name. And I'm sure that there are nicknames and or regular names that you've been given within your family that nobody else ever hears, only the immediate person who gave you the name or the immediate family. I've met a couple of people who have used a name and say, well, that's what so-and-so calls me, but Albie just held up a sign and I didn't see. What is that sign? I have...
I can only be here.
It's backwards. I can only...
be here this long, Wapala Benson.
Yes, okay. Oh, the here is H-E-R-E, not H-E-A-R. I was going to talk louder. Buh. Oops, there's that buh. here are a couple of teasing names. Twists the pipe. And it might be that that person has, you know, dropped the pipe or something during a ceremony and was kind of playfully scolded. Be more careful. I'm guessing, but that seems possible. Another one is afraid of sex. I should tell you about a crow person who was extremely important in history, and all the crows know about Oschish. Oschish is the shortened form of this person. It was a Berdash, a two-spirit person. In other words, a male who early on started to behave and dress like a female in all ways. The full name of this person is Ostigeptapesh. Ostigeptapesh. And as a young person, had been a fierce warrior even after she had become a female, and had the Ostigeptapesh means finds them and kills them. Finds them and kills them. And actually, when the crow party, a group of important crow leaders, went by train all the way to Washington, D.C. from southwestern Montana to meet with the president, Roosevelt, they had dinner in the White House. Now picture this, will you, y'all? Oschish is sitting next to Eleanor Roosevelt at this major White House banquet, dressed in a dress, hair done like a woman's, and putting on the woman's role. And they say that afterward, Eleanor hadn't realized that she was sitting next to a male. But Sheesh was a true female. So that's another story.
Someone is asking questions about other two-spirit names or naming traditions.
Oh my, yes, for sure. You have another hour. Well, I was at a doings one time, and the year before, it was on a neighboring reservation, and the year before, I had been given the Tonkan Saichia, the gravestone name, and they, when you're at a doing, say, well, if there's just one or two of the visitors, like I was at that point, they'll ask, do you have a name? And they don't mean, you know, Benson Lee Lanford. They mean, do you have a real name, an Indian name? And there was a man and a woman standing next to each other, and it was man and wife, and the man had the microphone and kind of turned to me, moved the microphone away and said, "Do you have a name?" "Yeah, Tonkan Saichia." And he kind of straightened up like this, and the woman turned her head and looked at me and dropped her voice and then said something in Lakota, very soft, to her husband. And the husband later asked me, "Do you know what a Wink'te person is?" And then just kind of half smiled at me, and I said, "Yeah, I know what we're, whoops, I know what they're like." And I slipped by saying they, of course, we, I know what we're like, whoops, they're like, was to let him know that I knew that he knew that. And later he came by when we were all taking a break and having coffee, and he said, "Man, you really dress well. You know how to dance." "Oh, I didn't tell you the rest of the name, Sha Sha, bright red. That time that I won that contest by continuing the dance, the fellow who called me that came over and said that means that you really look good when you dress and you've got good clothes. You know how to do things. That's a person we call Sha Sha." Well, then he kind of smiled and said, "It kind of means hot stuff." I'm bragging about myself, so I'll have to give a feast to buy back my reputation. So y'all come and I'll feed you well. Any other questions? I'm going to scan my paper here to see.
You know, Goldie is asking a question. And Goldie, I'm wondering, are you still there?
Yeah, he's there.
Can you turn on your microphone and ask your question? Because
yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
I have to read it.
Asking.
Yes, would people be given diminutive natured names to not draw attention to them or their families?
Yes, so like secondary names that are different from their powerful name. Is that what?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, very definitely. For example, I would use the term red spider, one that I've taken, kind of a lighthearted one, or two owls, my original name, so that I wouldn't use corn man or sweat lodge rocks. Yeah.
Okay.
Most people have more than one name, traditional people, that is, yes. Or nicknames, yeah. Fingernail is one of the ones I remember from years ago. This young lady was called Fingernail because she had sort of long, clean fingernails that she was often picking at. Fingernails, it was plural. That was her nickname. But I know what her real name was, but since she didn't use it very much, I'm not going to tell you that. In other words, there would be situations where I would not, having been around people for a while, I would hear names that would not, I wouldn't have the right courteously to say them in public, yeah. Like, I just did that on camera because I wanted to give myself another nickname. Wipes his nose. I mean, that's the sort of things that people will tease about, you know. Or belches loud, you know, that one name I gave you, and others. Oh, Kisses the Dog was another one that I know from a girl, a little girl who had a puppy and would kiss the top of the dog's head. Kisses the pup. Kisses the Dog, they translated it. And teasing names. Well, I mentioned the one afraid of sex already. Belches loud. Yeah. runs away fast was another nickname. In other words, gets the hell out of here because they're afraid of what's going to happen or that they might be asked to do something you don't want to, like help butcher or something. Yeah. Other comments or questions?
Yeah, any other questions?
Oh, I do have a couple of other things here. Pocahontas, that name means playful when I think I said, but her real name was Motuaca, but I don't know what that means. Does anybody? I've not been able to find that name. Pocahontas was her. And Malibu means loud surf. And Poughkeepsie means a reed-covered lodge. And Wyandotte is a band of Huron Indians. I don't know what it translates as, but Tallahassee and Cucamonga have to be other cities that have Indian names. Does anybody here come from a city that has an Indian name or a state that's named for an Indian tribe?
Winnemucca.
Oh, Michigan, Michigamea, where I was born.
Yeah, that's
literally means big lake. And Wisconsin, the word Wisconsin means that a river runs through the Red Country. And that refers to the red bluffs around the Wisconsin Dells. And that's really a neat name.
Wichita.
Wichita. Oh, yes.
Born in Wichita. I don't live there now, but Wichita.
Wichita is a tribe.
It is, and it's a big city now, I guess. I haven't been there for a long time.
Yes, my.
But that's what I grew up with was, you know, 70 years ago, the remains of whatever Native American strains that ran through that town at that time. I learned to bead and make rattles and stuff. It was There was some. There were some remnants in the city culture.
Thank you for sharing that. Oh, another name that is so incredible. I meant to tell you this earlier. Spits while he walks. Now, what could that come from? Spits while he walks. Actually, that's a powerful name because it refers to a buffalo bull or a buffalo, because as they walk, they go, and they often are drooling a bit. So it means it behaves in the manner of a buffalo. So spits while he walks. Oh. Well, I'll tell this to you anyway. Young Sue guy, a couple years younger than me, I knew years ago, says Pooping Bird was his name. And it referred to the fact that when he was in a ceremony one time, they were under a shade tree and a crow landed in the tree and dum, 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 on his shoulders. And so they nicknamed him Pooping Bird. And sometimes they just call him Pooper. I hope there are some smiles out there. Okay, turn the paper, see if there's some more stuff here.
So Benson, people are just commenting. Ginger says she grew up in Spokane, Washington. Someone grew up in Ukiah, meaning deep valley.
Ukiah?
Yeah.
And Siskiyou refers to a large redwood tree. And I talked about Luella Johnson, my crow-like sister, my sister-like crow lady. And her name translates as good person. And that's one of those honoring names that she was so incredibly generous and had been chosen to give dream names for kids and would often feast people or take lots, large amounts of food to feasts and all. So good person was her name.
Benson, I wonder if I could get you to chat about one thing as we kind of wind things down here. Mm-hmm. Is, you know, a lot of us in this community have taken on certain names for different reasons. And I sometimes get a little concerned about how politically correct that is or how respectful that is to tradition. And I wonder if you can speak about how those of us who are walking this path can maybe honor our own experiences as well as being respectful of the traditions that we're participating in, especially when it comes with this naming process. I mean, I think you've given us some great information. I wonder what would be your advice to our circle here?
Oh my, I'm gonna think about that for a second and look at the top of my page. And the first thing that I was supposed to say was to give you, all of you people and all of the others, mountains of gratitude for the support and the donations and everything that you've given this community here. The immediate community has lost 600 homes to the wildfires. The greater community has lost 1,600 homes, and business after business after business have gone. I lost my storage. Thank goodness the main collection was here. Our townhouse row is safe, but I did lose some blankets, and a couple of Pendletons have been sent to me to help because you need blankets. But I want to express sincere thank you, gratitude for the responses. And I want to thank you for inviting me to speak to you today. Okay, your question. I think that if a person does can get to Indian doings to attend them, whether it be a powwow or some kind of ceremony or a housewarming or something, if something like that goes on where you can get to it, do attend. Always ask when you arrive, either you contact beforehand or when you arrive, ask for the person ahead of things and then speak to them, especially if you don't know them or they don't know you, and say that I'm interested in things and I want to learn. I'd like to support in any way I can. And they'll probably explain what's going on or talk to you about those things. And they'll see that, well, here you are, you've shown up. And they'll probably pay you a little attention subsequently, especially if they see you at another doings, even of a different type of doings. And if you make your interests known, they'll respond generally, at least some people, at least probably most people would respond in kind and be encouraging. And instead of asking a direct question, it's more the correct style to say, oh, the way they're using that blanket, that is of interest. In other words, don't say, why are they using that blanket that way? Or a similar question. But you could say, I've always wanted to know more about, and then how they use that lead horse. Or I saw some moccasins with holes, round holes cut in the soles. I've always wondered about those, even though you've maybe never heard about them. But asking indirect questions is always a proper way of doing things. Or if you're at a doings and you could say, I was at a doings about a year ago, and they were getting ready to do something. Or I saw them. Well, that's a good way of doing it. Then you stop, and the person with whom you're speaking very likely will add to that. They're recognizing that that's an indirect question. Do I answer your question? Guess your question?
Yeah, it's interesting how you're doing this. I'm always wondering what's the appropriate way of walking in balance between like when you're talking about these names, it feels like it's a very culturally sacred process for people. And I'm just wondering, I wonder how Native people might experience seeing a lot of people kind of acquiring or appropriating names in a similar fashion.
You're going to get all sorts of reactions, depending a little bit, perhaps. It'll influence how you behave at a given doings, or where you attend a given doings. And sometimes you'll maybe be embraced completely, or absolutely. What are you doing this for? Well, I'll tell you one little thing. You know, I've been doing Indian dressing and dancing and all, going to doings ever since I was a kid. And I was maybe 7-8 years ago at a powwow in this greater area. And I was dressed in traditional prairie clothes, the style I've been wearing since I was, you know, a teenager. And a lady who was obviously most likely full blood and had on an Indian blouse, but had plaid jeans on and low heel shoes, medium heel, bright red shoes, came up to me. And she had her hair done in a beauty shop, kind of. And she looked, there was a pause in the doings. And I was just standing over to the side, waiting for something to happen, you know, another song, a drum to start singing, and people dancing again. And she walked not across the dance area, but kind of around the dance area, but a little bit too far into it, as if to say, okay, here I come, you see me. And she stopped in front of me, and I just, you know, looked at her, waited for it, knowing that something was coming. And she said, why do you do this? And I leaned forward a little bit and I said, and Sue means, you know, what did you just say? And she said, what? And I switched to English and I said, oh, I thought you were an Indian. And oh, she just looked at me as if I had slapped her and walked away. And I think she knew that she had been out of you know, sorts. But I felt kind of ashamed that I had been that way. But why should I take that anyway?
Yeah.
Well, I did say after I translated that, she said, what? And I said, I thought you were an Indian. And I said, well, I've been doing this since I was a kid. But she walked away.
Well, Benson, I want to thank you for your generosity. You and I have been communicating, and I know that you've been doing lots of research for this. I know that you've been preparing for a couple of weeks to prepare for this group. And so I want to thank you. And Zoom is kind of awful because you can't do applause. But in the deaf community, if there's an event, people do this. So I think you can see everyone applauding.
I should mention, if I may, for years I've been interested in names, and in my computer, the documents, I have lists and lists and lists from close, longtime friends who have sent things, Ottawa's and Wichita's and other people. So if y'all want to see names, oh, honey, I've got them.
Well, we want to thank you. Again, I just want to remind folks, if they want to participate in making an offering, I've put the link on the chat box. Send Benson our love and support. Again, we meet every Sunday at 1 o'clock. I post it everywhere on Facebook. I'm not a huge social media connector, but that's the one place that people tend to hear about it. You're welcome to join us. Missing everyone around the country and the world, and someday we will hug and embrace in person. So thank you very much. And I'm going to unmute so we can do our Walton farewell.
Two good things. Is that that's Lainey sitting on the couch behind you, isn't it?
Yes, yeah. It is.
Yeah. And I want to do this. That sign is a thank you sign to many of the plains and prairie people, going like this. And you'll see beaded hands on Osage women's skirts and blankets, wearing blankets. And that means blessings on you and thank you. That's Delaney. And he just did it again, so I have to do it again.
All right, well, thank you, everyone, and farewell. Until next time.
Thank you.
Farewell.
Thank you.